"You villain," said he, "where's your daughter?" The fat man cast his eyes round and then up at the open skylight. "It is for me to ask you that," he shrieked. "You thieves, spies and thieves, I have caught you, have I? You are in my power. I'll serve you." He turned and clattered down the stairs as hard as he could go. "He's gone for the dog," cried Miss Hunter. "I have my revolver," said I. "Better close the front door," cried Holmes, and we all rushed down the stairs together. We had hardly reached the hall when we heard the baying of a hound and then a scream of agony with a horrible worrying sound which it was dreadful to listen to. An elderly man with a red face and shaking limbs came staggering out at a side door. "My God!" he cried. "Someone has loosed the dog. It's not been fed for 2 days. Quick, quick, or it'll be too late." Holmes and I rushed out round the angle of the house with Toller hurrying behind us. There was a huge famished brute, its black muzzle buried in Ruckarsel's throat, while he writhed and screamed upon the ground. Running up, I blew its brains out, and it fell over with its keen white teeth still meeting in the great creases of his neck. With much labour, we separated them and carried him living but horribly mangled into the house. We laid him upon the drawing-room sofa, and having dispatched the sobered Toller to bear the news to his wife, I did what I could to relieve his pain. We were all assembled round him when the door opened, and a tall, gaunt woman entered the room. "Mrs. Toller," cried Miss Hunter.
"Yes, miss. Mr. Ruckarsel let me out when he came back before he went up to you. Ah, miss, it is a pity you didn't let